My name is George Agatsiotis. First of all, I want to thank you for, you know, for taking your time to do this video, you know, for me, myself, and my family. I'm married. I have, you know, my wife, Katerini, and I have two beautiful daughters, Maria and Eleni. And, I'm a St. Demetrios Greek Orthodox Church member since 71 that I came in this country, my parents and then me. And we came in this country in 1970, July 15th. And we moved, you know, first place we moved, it was here in Upper Darby, and we stay here ever since then.
What part of Greece do you hail from?
Greece, I was born in Katerini. My parents, they're both immigrants in Greece. They came from Asia Minor. My father, you know, was born Rhodestos, Anatolikis Thrakis. Η μητέρα μου, η καταγωγή της είναι από την Ήπειρο. Μετά εγκατασταθήκανε όταν το κάψαν το χωριό τους, είναι από εκεί, φύγανε και κατασταθήκανε στην Κοζάνη, στο καταφύγιο Κοζάνης. Και μετά τον πόλεμο, το δεύτερο παγκόσμιο πόλεμο, όταν κάψανε το χωριό της μητέρας μου, κατεβήκανε στο νομό Πιερία στην Κατερίνη και φτιάξανε το συνοικισμό. Ο πατέρας μου είχε έρθει στην Κατερίνη το 22, δύο χρονών, όπως είπα, από το Ροδεστό Ανατολικής Θράκης. Εμείς, εάν το σκεφτούμε και αυτό, εγώ και τα αδέρφια μου και η οικογένεια, όσοι γι' αυτό που γεννηθήκαμε, και τα αδέρφια του πατέρα μου φυσικά, που γεννηθήκαν στην Ελλάδα, εμείς είμαστε η πρώτη γενιά που είμαστε ελεύθεροι. Ο πατέρα μου γεννήθηκε κάτω από την Τουρκοκρατίας. And most of his, you know, paperwork that he has, everything is in, you know, in Turkish. Mm-hmm. So I came across some of those documents. Then they decided, over the years, then, you know, 1970, we decided and we came to the United States for, mm-hmm. for a better, you know, future for, you know, for us and, you know, for the family.
Part of your youth, or most of your youth, was actually spent in Greece. Could you share some of your fondest memories growing up in Greece?
I mean, for, you know, fun memories. It was, we were, you know, farming family. You know, they had a, you know, small farm. You know, my parents. And they were working agriculture, mainly, you know, tobacco, because it was a big thing in Katerini, in the area at the time. 1967, when the dictatorship, quote unquote, took place in Greece, we stopped, you know, planting, you know, tobacco, and my father got a job and worked for a company, you know, for a tour. They built, you know, they had a hotel, you know, with a small hotel and rooms they were renting, and he was a night guard and taking care of the, you know, the grounds for a few years. And, you know, and after, you know, after that, you know, we were there on the summer times. We used to go there when school was closed, because, you know, all the other times it was we had to work on the farm, you know, work with the tobacco, you know, on the tobacco farm and every other work. And then at that time, which was good for us because we were able to go, you know, swimming, you know, because it was right up on, you know, front of the beach. And we used to go swimming, and, you know, also I started working, you know, at the restaurant, because they had a restaurant at that place. I started working in the kitchen, you know, helping.
Right.
And that was it. Yeah. You know, favorite times, it was the school. I finished, you know, elementary school. And then I always wanted to go, you know, my trade, even though most of the times I was a good student, sometimes I was sleeping. Mm-hmm. And I always, my ambition was, you know, wanted to be, you know, auto mechanic. Oh. Or, you know, something that has to do, you know, with the auto, you know, automobile and, you know, heavy machines, equipment, stuff like that. So, I enrolled in the school. It was an electrical school, mechanical electrical, in Katerini, Thalis Omelisios. I graduated from there. I took my test The last, you know, test that I took, it was the test at the time that was given by the government. It wasn't by the school. It was government representatives that were coming in, and they were giving us the tests. And I think I did pretty good. I think my diploma says it was 17.8 average. And I finished. And we came here in the United States. I also finished up the three-year, you know, the middle school, as what they call it now, the three-year, the middle school, you know, at night, we used to go at night. Fun memories, you know, growing up as a kid, you know, in a neighborhood, you know, it was a tight neighborhood, and it was. We had a lot of fun. We're playing, you know, we're flying kites. We used to do, aerostato, we used to call them. We used to get those big, you know, sacks, you know, made with a very fine, thin paper. We used to fill it up with smoke. And, you know, it used to go up, you know, it's like a balloons, you know, going up in the air. We're playing as, you know, kids in the neighborhood. A lot of other things. One of our neighbors, you know, always was a challenge for us to do something, and one, you know, all the kids that were competing, you know, who's going to do something different. We used to make our own scooters. We used to, you know, like nothing like now, you go up to a store and you buy it. Then we used to, you know, it was one of our neighbors, he used to overhaul heavy equipment, and he was taking the time, instead of breaking them or cutting them, taking out the bearings, the ball bearings, and giving it to us so we can make, you know, our little scooters. Playing around, that was it, you know. A couple of times we used to innovating, then it was stupid, you know, the more you think, you know, think about it, but now that I think of it, I'm laughing, but it was a dangerous thing, you know, what we used to do, we used to cut a hole in the ground with the tomato cans, and I used to go and get acetylene. At the time it was coming in a form of a rock. We used to put water in little pieces of acetylene, slide the can on the top of it, seal it with, you know, with a dirt, we had a hole in the center, we used to keep our finger on all the time, and another guy with a long stick, he had the fire, he used to, you know, light him up, and it used to blow up in the air. A couple of times I came home with my eyebrow hanging down because he caught me on the forehead. But, you know, that was the, you know, the fun years that we grow up. We didn't know anything about cell phones, tablets, computers. It was a horror, you know, a horror at the time. And that was the good years that we had. And then I came in this country, and...
Would you say that those youthful experiences, being creative, inspired you or motivated you to go into the mechanic field?
Yes, that had a lot to do with it, because whatever we built as a kids, one helping the other and giving ideas one with the other, you know, it was something that we create things that we see now, but it was something that was, you know, from back in there, you know, those days. Instead of, you know, go buying it from the store, we used to make it. Mm-hmm. We used to make little, you know, carriages, carrying stuff around, you know, or, you know, toys and stuff like that. We were daring a lot of times, you know, going somewhere the cliffs that were, you know, 10, 15, you know, 20 feet up. We used to jump, try to, you know, jump across. A couple of times I came back, you know, home, I was bruised up, limping, but, you know, that was part of life growing up. You know, it's, I had my mom all the time. She was, you know, she was hollering and tried to reprimand me to be more careful, but, you know, kids, they're always kids.
What kind of kid were you, though? Were you
a... I was, you know, I wasn't, you know, bad, you know, not that I want to brag, I wasn't a bad kid. You know, I always avoided trouble. I always respect the elders. Respect, you know, the priests when they were walking, you know, because back in those days they were walking in the neighborhoods, coming in and visiting here and there. We always ran to, you know, kiss their hand, you know, the priests.
Let's talk about the journey of immigration, your personal story. There are many diaspora communities around this country. What brought you to Philadelphia?
We came to Philadelphia at the time, you know, because my mom, she was a seamstress. So at the time, that's where they were looking, you know, more of the, you know, the seamstresses, you know, they were the jobs, you know, the textile. And they were one of the few factories that were left. It was in Philadelphia. Everything else, slowly at the, you know, at the beginning of the 70s, they started moving out of the country. In Philadelphia, it was still a thriving community, you know, textile, you know, for garments, you know, women's garments, men's, you know, garments for kids. A lot of, most of the women, you know, and, you know, they came, and a lot of men, they were, you know, they were rafters, you know, kind of in a costume, they got jobs, you know, to, you know, at those factories. Same thing, you know, with my mother. My mother worked in a couple other places. The last one she worked, it was H.R. Freeman & Sons. It was where today is the, you know, on Arch Street, Thor and Arch, I think, was the last, one of their last stands, and then they moved out in by the airport, mm-hmm. You know, where the Drexel is now. You know, they acquired that property, and she worked there for about 15 years. Actually, she retired through, you know, from that place. And my father worked, you know, at a restaurant. And, you know, when he retired, you know, in the 80s somewhere, I can't remember exactly. Probably, I think I was 86, my father retired. In 87 or 89, my mom retired. And that was, you know, it. And for that reason, you know, we came, we stayed in Philadelphia. I never, even though I did went to school in Indiana, you know, Pennsylvania, you know, in Blairsville, where it was a technical school, and I was taking courses in Indiana University, because in the beginning I always wanted to teach, you know, the younger kids, you know, what, you know, become a teacher, you know, for the automotive industry, you know, to learn, you know, teach the, you know, the young kids coming out, a technical trade. But just like everybody else, you know, when you see, you know, money, we were money hungry, we wanted to, you know, be, you know, work and you know, develop and become, you know, something. You know, we measure everything, you know, in the value of, you know, how, you know, how much, and, you know, what, you know, and the money. And, you know, that's one kind of regret that I didn't finish the school. You know, I needed, you know, another 6 months, you know, 3 more credits to finish up. I stopped because, you know, work, and, you know, to me at the time it was, you know, working and try to make money and help the, you know, my parents, because I didn't want them to keep, you know, pay for the school. I work and I pay myself, you know, through school. I never got a loan, you know, so when I did graduate, I graduated, you know, scot-free. I had no loans, payments, no nothing. And after that, I got a job and I started working on the trade.
You are a small business owner that's been in this community with a great reputation, G&A Auto Body, but you also have some roots with another company that was up on Westchester Pike. Share with us a little bit about this journey to developing your own business and how it runs today.
I always, you know, wanted, you know, had it in the back of my mind. I wanted to, you know, I was going to have my own business. When I, you know, came out on the industry and started working, I worked as a, you know, about a couple of years as a mechanic. And then, you know, the job opened up, you know, for the auto body industry. And it was one of the owners from Classic Coach Works in Westchester Pike in Upper Darby. We were going to, you know, to the technical school. Folker of Votech School, who was a technical school, you know, and he was 2 years older than me. He graduated, and I knew him from then. And when he opened up, you know, the business, he stopped by, brought a car to, you know, for us to do an inspection there, and I seen him and started talking. He says, "Why don't you come and work for me?" He says, "Why are you staying here?" In the beginning, I felt bad. I didn't want to leave, you know, the people that they gave me a job, but the money was good. Plus, I always wanted to change to that field. So, I went and I started working, doing, the body work. I worked for them for 13 years. I put a lot of, hours, and I did, it was a very good experience, for what I did, for my trade. And I had the opportunity to work from an average, car to, expensive, an exotic cars. I even worked at the, it was a, one of the gentlemen that it was very good, money-wise, he was, Nick Parakis, he was a developer slash he had shopping centers, and he was very well off, good money. And they brought over, he went in Greece, when they auctioned off from the royal family, and he brought over the Rolls Royce that was, it is Vasilisas Friderikis, it was the her own, personal car. Mm-hmm. They brought it over. Mm-hmm. When they were shipping it, or it was from there, it was damaged. So they brought the car over, and I walked the front of the car. It was, parked on the sidewalk, and my boss comes in, he says, "You don't recognize the car?" I looked at it, I said, that car don't mean nothing to me, because I didn't have anything like this, in Greece. He says, "Look at it pretty good." And when I seen, in front, it had the, the royal crown, emblem. I really said, then he told me, he says, dumb Greek, he says, "That's the royal, from the royal family. That's Vasilisas Friderikis car." I said, "That's good for her." So, I repaired that car. And a gentleman, he bought it in an auction. And he bought it, I think he still has it, It was, that was one of the highlights. Some of the other exotic cars that I, fixed over the years. It was a challenge, everything that I did in my life. And the harder the challenge was, the more, it seemed like I succeeded, even more and more. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Does your brother?
My brother is my partner. I started GA, from, George Agatsiotis, but also in the back of my mind always was George and Art. Αργύρισε ο αδερφός μου. Και έχω και την αδερφή μου που είναι η Αναστασία, η οποία είναι παντρεμένη στον Ζόρζη, είναι στην οικογένεια Μπαλή, έχει παντρευτεί. Και μαζί με τον αδερφό μου μετά αρχινήσαμε να συνεργαζόμαστε και αγοράσαμε το μέρος, είναι το συνεργείο, και κάναμε αυτά που έχουμε μέχρι τώρα.
Yeah. You've been a member, a dedicated member, some would even say the most dedicated member of St. Demetrios over the years. When did you first come and join the parish of St. Demetrios, and what does this community mean to you?
Well, this is the only community we knew when we came here in Upper Darby. It was 1970. 71, I joined, the Sunday school. After the Sunday school, we joined the Goya. After the Goya, we helped, whatever the church needed it. And if it was any fundraisers or any events, we tried to help. I was a youngster at the time. I was helping, in the dances, I was helping on the bar or this and that, clean up, set up, which I met a lot of good people, in this church, and a lot of dedicated people. And to me, it became as a challenge again, because when the elders, they left us with something, I gotta leave something behind, the legacy, to my, my kids or my grandkids, if I'm fortunate enough to have any. But still, it's something, that's, a line of, you keep, moving up and, do, what we have to do, for the community. And that's how it became. I got it, after that, it was Father Andreu, Costadinos Andreu, he was a priest. When I came back from school and started working here, he called me one day. I was coming to church whenever I was here on the weekends. He asked me if I want to join and help them, with the Goya. And I got involved with the Goya, then I got involved with the, then the basketball team, came the next thing from the Goya. We started having, the basketball team. There was some of the, I was fortunate enough to have a lot of good kids. Mm-hmm. And one of you is, Terry Constance and, you know, the whole group that was about 15 of them. But, you know, I remember the names and stuff, you know, a lot of the names, you know, I'm not going to mention all the names.
It's too long.
It's too long.
That was a big Goya.
And we started a basketball team. Was something that was, you know, I didn't know a whole lot about basketball because, you know, all my years, a couple of years that I did, you know, on the sports, I played soccer or, you know, wrestling, and I was it. You know, the kids always respect me. That's one thing I have to say. You know, they were very good, you know, and I was proud of them. I will go up to the bat no matter, you know, what's going to happen. I always defend, you know, τον Άγιο Δημήτριο, την Αγία την Εκκλησία μας, you know, and our, you know, την κοινότητα, because it was part of us.
And we're thankful to you for what you did for us.
Yeah.
Let's move to this next question, which is, you have a passion for cooking, which is completely different than your profession.
Yeah.
Where did you learn to cook? What are the challenges to cook on a large scale for all the Greek events in St. Demetrios?
Well, cooking started when I was probably 12, 13 years old, when I was still over in Greece. And my father, as I said earlier, working at a resort, and they had a restaurant. And instead of me running around, you know, the chef and my parents, they wanted me to do something instead of, you know, running around all summer. So they said, you know, he says, come on over in the kitchen. And I started, you know, helping, you know, moving stuff around. And he says, forget about that. He says, come on, you know, and help me, you know, you're going to help me. And I started, you know, little by little, he was showing me what to do. And he said, you know, he always joking, he says, learn how to cook. You know, I didn't want to do it because I always wanted to become a mechanic. You know, that was, to me, I was doing it as a, you know, I don't know, angaria που λένε στην Ελλάδα. But he always, you know, always telling me, he says, learn, you know, the trade and learn how to cook because you don't know how, you know, your wife is, you know, is going to be. If she knows how to cook, at least you know how, you know, you're going to eat. But at least, I'm fortunate enough, my wife is an excellent cook on that matter. And I, you know, little bit by little, I learned, you know, the two summers that I spent there. I always, as I said, everything that I did always has ambition, and I wanted to do it, you know, the best I could. I never did anything half-assed. If it was anything half-assed, I walked away.
Right.
And when I came here, same thing with the elders, you know, I was helping them, and I always keep my eyes open and looking at what they do, how they do it.
So you immediately came... When you came into Philadelphia in 1970, right away you joined the church.
We joined the church, and I joined, you know, I said the youth programs, and then, you know, the Goya. Getting in the kids and stuff like that, it was, you know, late, you know, in the 80s. Until then, it was a lot of older, you know, gentlemen that was here, and I was helping them. One of the best mentors that I had was Angelo Nicolaou, because he, at the time, he had the catering, and he's the one, it taught me the portions, how to portion things up, you know, per person. And if I know I got to do cook for 100 or 200, don't tell me how to cook for four people, because I know, you know, if I start with four and end up with 40, I eat, you know, the same food for a week afterwards. And, you know, he told, you know, that's how I learned, you know, the basics, you know, to portion things up. And, you know, and from there on, as if you do something and you have a passion for it, mm-hmm. I like to cook. It's a hobby, you know, to me. I, you know, no matter how tired I am from my work, when I come and I get in the kitchen, you know, to me it's relaxing. You know, some people, they think it's a lot. But to me, you know, I relax. I enjoy it. You know, I love to have people with me. We're joking around. We, you know, we curse at each other when we get mad. You know, we, you know, scream and holler. But, you know, everything's get done and everybody eats. And, you know, as long as they're happy, that's all, you know, that's
right.
All I want.
Yeah.
You know, and, you know, the food, it's, you know, it's decent. We're trying to do it our best, you know, and I'm fortunate enough, I have a lot of good helpers. They come around. My kubaro Dimitri, you know, Papayoannou, Thomas Papacharas. Τώρα τελευταία είχαν έρθει κάτι άλλα παιδιά, ο Τσίτσιος, ο Θόδωρος και κάτι άλλοι. Over the years ήταν ο Χρήστος, ο Παπαχρήστος, ο οποίος, και αυτός με, you know, με έμαθε πολλά, γιατί ήταν, he was a very good, you know, cook. And that's how we end up where, you know, I end up now, you know, holding up. Hopefully somebody else is going to take over after me.
Right. Well, you are synonymous with this kitchen here at St. Mm-hmm. Demetrios. In fact, when I speak to people outside of this church, they think of Spanakopita, they think of Yotiko, right in the kitchen.
Yeah.
That's something you've been doing for a long time. In fact, when we arrived, you were prepping a delivery
for
a private customer that wanted to come in and have the spanakopita directly that you make.
I'm fortunate, again, as I said, fortunate enough, I have our older ladies, I shouldn't say that, but our ladies, they brought from home, you know, the old traditions, how to make everything homemade, and our responsibility, because it's too much work for them to do. The only thing they do the filo, we do the stuffing, whether it's the cheese or spinach. You know, some of the guys we get together, we saute, the onions, the spinach, all that. We make the mixture for them to their likings, the way they want it. And then, we help them, with the pitas. And, our responsibility is just to cook them afterwards. But they do, all the work, which is a very hard work to do that. You know, we don't make anything, everything's from scratch.
Well, many people know that George Agatsiotis, he's the main chef for the church events. Is there a favorite church event for you that you like to cook for, that you just love doing it?
I mean, I don't have anything favorite. Anything has to do with the church, fundraisers, and it has to do with cooking, doesn't bother me. As I said, to me, it's something that I enjoy doing it, and I will, as I said, no matter what they're going to ask me to cook, mm-hmm. If I don't know anything, I won't ask. I'm going to, maybe I do a try, over at the house a couple of times. So, I can perfect whatever, mistakes I made in the first or second. So that way I can have it, for the people, to enjoy it. Our basketball, program, it went kind of in disarray after a few years. And when I took over, the second time, I had a hard time finding a coach. When I did, that, we're discussing with some other people, and Yanni, he just graduated. Yeah, John Vasiliou graduated from school, and he came in as a customer. And at the time I needed a coach, I figured out, I said, you know what, let me ask him. Even though he went to St. Luke's, the family moved out that way, which was normal for a lot of kids. And I said, Yanni, I said, do you mind? I asked you a question. He says, what? He says, I'm looking for a coach. I said, for Upper Darby, for St. Demetrios.
We are talking about
John Vasiliou. Mm-hmm. I said, do you mind giving me a hand? The hand was, as soon as he came in, I walked right out, and he took over. But I didn't do it intentionally. I always tell him, I said, everything you need, I said, I'm here. I was sitting on the back line, which is, Yanni did an excellent job. Actually, I'm very proud of για το Γιάννη, γιατί ήταν ένα από τα λίγα παιδιά τα οποία έφερα στην εκκλησία, and he stayed with it, through that. Now he's on the board. He's on the board of the diocese, it's a very big accomplishment, for somebody.
Are there any favorite church memories that you have from the festivals? And is there a favorite dish that you like to eat or prep?
The main thing, as a dish is to do, we're trying to do everything in the tradition, Greek way. We're not, not to cut any corners. I enjoy, we did, the kokinisto for years, the lamb, kokinisto. Now we're doing the shanks, which is something. It's a complicated, but also it's a very good. You have very good outcome. To me, enjoying, to eat. Honestly, when I work, I don't like, I don't want to eat anything.
Oh, really?
I take some home and I eat, at night, because, I'm tired. I always wanted to finish up with whatever comes in and out the ovens or, the stoves. So eating is the last thing I do. But, as I said, I will enjoy a good gyro or a good, souvlaki, or a good, pasticcio, which is, one of my favorites. And lamb, and that's mainly.
Well, Yorgo, you've served the church in every capacity possible, from chairing the festival to running the monthly homeless feeding, coaching Goya basketball, which we mentioned before. You were president of the parish council. How do you, or more or less, what motivates you to continue doing this for St. Demetrius and this community?
Well, the motivation started when I was 14. And, you know, the night that I was leaving to come to the United States. Our parish, it was Yaya Triada, there were priests. They had three priests. The oldest, it was Opatir Kostas. He was 89, probably in his 90s at the time, late 80s and early, maybe 90s. He retired and they gave him a small church, Agios Φώτιος, ήταν μια μικρή εκκλησίτσα στην Κατερίνη. Και ο ιερέας, ο Παπακώστας, αυτός είχε έρθει από το Ροδεστό, Ανατολική Θράκης. Αυτός ήταν ο παπάς ο οποίος στεφάνωσε τους παππούδες μου, βάφτισε όλα τα παιδιά τους, τον πατέρα μου, στεφάνωσε τον πατέρα μου και την μητέρα μου και βάφτισε όλους εμάς.
Wow.
Το βράδυ που θα φεύγαμε, είχε ακούσει ότι φεύγαμε, θα έρθουμε στην Αμερική και ήρθε και κάθισε στο σπίτι. Είχα γυρίσει αργά, να σου πω την αλήθεια, ήταν πακάτι. 12.30 μία η ώρα είχαμε γυρίσει με την παρέα τα παιδιά όλοι. Γιατί θα φεύγαμε την άλλη μέρα να με αποχαιρετήσουν. Και αυτός καθόταν και περίμενε. Usually, you know, that age, θα θέλανε να πάνε να κοιμηθούν, να ξεκουραστούν. Which is logical. Περίμενε εκεί πέρα και μόλις τον είδα, σηκώθηκε. Μόλις τον είδα στο σπίτι, λέω, εγώ νόμιζα κάτι έπαθε εκεί, ήταν ο παπάς εκεί πέρα, you know, τρόμαξα. Μου λέει, γεια σου, you know, πάντα με φώνεζε Γιώργο, Γιώργιος, του παππού μου το όνομα ήταν Γιώργης. And that's why he loved, you know, calling me. You know, and everybody was calling me, you know, in Greece, you know, George, you know, Γιώργο, very rare. Μου λέει, παιδί μου, λέει, περίμενε να σε έρθω να σε αποχαιρετήσω, μου είπε ο παπάς, ο Παπακώστας. Του λέω, ευχαριστώ, πάτερ. Μου λέει, παιδί μου, θα σου πω ένα πράγμα, θα σου πω μια αριθμή, λέει, άμα θέλεις, άκουσέ την, μια συμβουλή. Του λέω, εντάξει, είναι ο πάτερ, λέω, την ευχή σας να είναι και ό,τι. Μου λέει, παιδί μου, λέει, εκεί που θα πας, η χώρα αυτή είναι, λέει, μια μεγάλη χώρα. Αλλά προσπάθησε, λέει, να μην ξεχάσεις, λέει, τρία πράγματα στη ζωή σου για να μην χαθείς. Θρησκεία, πατρίδα, οικογένεια. Εάν τα βαστίξεις αυτά, λέει, you're never gonna lose τις βάσεις τις οποίες έχεις σαν Έλληνας, Ορθόδοξος, οικογενειάρχης. Και τον ευχαρίστησα, του φίλησα το χέρι. Και μετά, όταν ήρθαμε εδώ, συζητούσαμε με τον αυτό. Αυτός ο άνθρωπος δεν είχε φύγει καμιά φορά από την Κατερίνη. Πώς ήξερε για αυτή τη χώρα πώς είναι να σε τέτοιο αυτό και πώς μπορεί να σε αφομοιώσει και να σε κάνει να χάσεις όλα αυτά. Και τα λόγια του, as the years went by, when I started going to Sunday school, started going to Στογκόγια, μετά μπήκα στο συμβούλιο, στην εκκλησία, άρχισαν να δουλεύουν στο κεφάλι μου. I never forgot him, even to this day. Και this is my motivation. Αυτά τα λόγια τα οποία μου είχε δώσει και βάστηξα και εδώ πέρα στην Αμερική, όταν με τη σύζυγό μου και τα παιδιά μου πηγαίναμε στο μοναστήρι της Αγίας Σκέπης και ο Διάλτορ, ο οποίος άρχισε αυτά όλα τα μοναστήρια, ήταν ο πατήρ Εφραίμ, που έχει κοιμηθεί τώρα, είναι ο πατήρ Εφραίμ της Αριζόνας, που ο οποίος λέγεται. Και τον εγνώρισα και ήταν μία από τις αδελφές, η οποία ήταν. Και μου λέει, όλοι με λέγανε και Γιώργο, I don't know why, you know, I mean, I never, you know, put myself to that level, but anyways, you know, I guess out of respect, you know, because, you know, my age, or whatever. Μου λέει, θα πας να δεις, λέει, το γέροντα. Εγώ δεν αισθανόμουν άνετα να δω το γέροντα, γιατί όλοι πηγαίνανε, αυτό, γιατί ήταν ο άνθρωπος, ήταν σε ηλικία, ήταν frail. I don't want to, you know, waste his time, να του πω ότι, you know, μας έβλεπε, μας σταύρωνε όταν πηγαίναμε, πέραμε το αντίδωρο, you know, φιλούσαμε το χέρι του. Λέω, τώρα τι άλλο να του πω. Αυτή επέμενε. Τελικά πήγα. Αγκέβη είναι και πήγα. Ήταν με τρεις άλλους κύριοι που ήμασταν μαζί. Μπήκαν στο δωμάτιο και ήταν ένα μικρό δωμάτιο. Έπρεπε να τραβήγω, να έρθω στα πλάγια και να κλείσω την πόρτα για να κουλήσω την πόρτα. Και ο γέροντας καθόταν απέναντι και μου γυρνάει και μου κάνει «Τζορτζάκι, παιδί μου», μου λέει, «έλα και κάθισε ακριβώς δίπλα μου». Και actually τα λόγια ήταν ακριβώς «Τζορτζάκι, μανάκα», μου λέει, «έλα και κάθισε δίπλα μου εδώ πέρα». «Έχει, τι έχεις», λέει, «να μου πεις». Του λέω, «Δέσποτα, γέροντα», του λέω, «την ευχή σας», λέω, «θέλω». Όλα τα άλλα τα έχουμε πει, λέω, δεν έφτω. Μόνο την ευχή σας αυτό, λέω, μου φτάνει εμένα. Βγήκα από το δωμάτιο. Μόλις βγήκα έξω και αυτό, τότε με χτύπησε στο κεφάλι. Στην Αμερική καμιά φορά κανένας δεν ήξερε το όνομα μου. Ο μόνος που με φώναζε είναι τα αδέρφια μου. Και κανένας άλλος, όλοι με ξέρουν Γιώργο. Αυτό ήταν το όνομα που είχαμε, ήταν του παππού μου. Το όνομά του. Και ήταν ο μόνος που με φώναξε στην Αμερική χωρίς να με ξέρει. Μετά πήγα και ρώτησα. Άξιολη την αδερφή της, λέω, αδερφή, λέω, μήπως είπατε το γέροντα, ο τάδε με τον. Όχι, παιδί μου, λέω, δεν μπορούμε να το κάνουμε με αυτό. Λέω, γίνεται. Πού να προλαβαίνω να γράφω ονόματα, λέει, και να διαβάζει κι αυτός. Θα πηγαίνετε και λέτε το όνομά σου και παίρνει την ευχή του. Ωραία, έτσι λέω, δεν είπα τίποτα. Συζητούσα με τη γυναίκα μου και λέω, δέσπος η θεία πρόνοια. Εάν θέλει να το πιστέψει ή δεν το πιστέψει, αλλά αυτό το πιστεύω εγώ αυτό. Πως ο Θεός τους στέλνει ανθρώπους σαν κι αυτούς να σε κάνουν εκεί που πας να γλιστρήσεις λίγο να φύγεις, να σε ξαναφέρουν πάλι στον ίδιο τον δρόμο. Τα λόγια αυτού του γέροντα Εφραίμ, που με φώναξε με το όνομα, εκείνη τη στιγμή όταν έκλεισα τα μάτια μου, θυμήθηκα τη μητέρα του πατέρα μου, τη γιαγιά μου, γιατί την κουβέντα μανάκα είναι μια λέξη την οποία τη λένε πολλοί οι Θρακιώτες από τον Ροδεστό Ανατολική Θράκης. Τζορτζάκι, κανένας δεν με είχε πει για να με φώναξε στην Αμερική. Ήταν ο μόνος που με φώναξε και που τα ήξερα αυτά τα δύο. Αυτή είναι η θεία πρόνοια, η οποία στη θρησκεία μας, η θρησκεία μας είναι ζωντανή και αν θέλουμε να το πιστέψουμε ή όχι, θαύματα γίνονται κάθε μέρα. Ο σκοπός είναι πρέπει να ανοίξουμε την ψυχή μας να τα δούμε. Mm-hmm. Και για μένα αυτό είναι ένα κάλεσμα.
Your wife and your daughters are also involved here at St. Demetrios. Describe what they do and what this means to you to have them also so close to this parish.
My wife, I met her when we were going, in high school. We kind of drift away over the years, and then when we came back and I was, at the church, we started seeing each other again, and after 84, 83, we kind of got back together. In 84 we got engaged and then we got married in 85. She was, honestly to tell you, she was the love of my life. I loved her when we were in high school, but I never said, anything, it was one of those. And then over the years, at the time when I approached her, we needed, dance, instructor. We didn't have one. So I knew she was dancing at the group at the time, at the time, the Terpsichoreans, who was in Philadelphia, was one of the very big group, dance group. And I knew she was a good dancer, and she knew how to, all, the different types of dances. And I asked her to help, if she can help. And she did, got involved with the dance group, at St. Demetrios. And then we got married, we had our kids. Same thing with our kids, they follow, the dance group. The point in society, here and there, and that's how we got, they got involved, and then, anything, any events, they were always here, with us, so I guess they follow the leads, their parents, and they join. My youngest one, she's involved, they were involved with the Goya, and and the oldest one with the dance group and the Goya. And they danced, with the church, and then they went again, and they took over for a couple of years. They took over the dance group and the Goya. That's about it. I mean, other than that, my wife, she's involved with the, she was involved with the choir, this and that. Now they're all involved with Philoptochos, so.
Is there a favorite time of year or religious holiday that you kind of like to see happen or you really enjoy?
I enjoy Easter. To me it's, it's a very big holiday, for our church. It's the, even though it's sad, we celebrate in the crucifixion of our, our Christ. But also, we're celebrating the resurrection, which is open up the gates for us to go to heaven. Because if it wasn't the resurrection, the death and resurrection, ikimi sigeri to resurrection of Jesus Christ, we'll never be able to go to have, you know, to heaven, to give us the chance for the rest of us. It's the whole family, you know, we get together, we do our, you know, the Greek traditions, we come to the church. I try to stay almost to the end, which is lately now, I can do it. When I was younger, we used to leave earlier, but now, I stay until the end of the church. And that's one of my favorites, because the whole family gets together and we enjoy each other's, company. We, cook, and, we have, good time.
Some people wonder that, does Yorgo have a home or a home life? Because if you show up here day, night, Yorgo's in the kitchen doing something. Do you have a spare time?
I try to, have a little bit of time, with the kids and, the wife. To me, when I go home, after work, if I see the, the family's there and everybody's all right, that's all I need. I want them, I want them to have nothing, it's going to be missing off of them, any shortages or anything. And as long as they're happy and they're healthy, that's all that matters. I'm thankful, thank God, they're always, no matter what we go through, we always, we come up healthy, and it's, keeping us healthy, to do whatever we do. And we try to, our way, to, pay back, for whatever he does for us. Well, I use Demetrios, or Kyrios. Honestly, tell you the truth, I use Demetrios, it's my home, out of my house, I always stay, then that's why one of the things, I stay close, I didn't move too far, I always, within 10 minutes, from the church. And I like to stay, helping the community and, be part of this community, because it was part of us.
Yorgo, thank you for talking with us, and best endeavors. We are grateful eternally for your work in this community, and specifically St. Demetrios. God bless you.
I want to thank you, Stu, also, both of you, Vasily and Terry, and Cosmos Philly, for giving me that opportunity to express my, my values and, my thoughts, for the Greek community and the community of St. Demetrios, actually. Thank you very much.